morning. Oh, good morning. It's good to see it's good to see everybody out this morning. Just fortunate to be here. Amen. I thank the good Lord for every opportunity we get to come into His house. Amen. Brother Dave Presley, would you lead us in prayer, brother? Yes. Amen. Wouldn't it be a good day to see somebody get born again, wouldn't it? I'd like to see somebody get saved this morning. This is the place to do it. Of course, any place is the place to do it. All you got to do is call upon the name of the Lord. Amen. If you would stand this morning, get your All-American Church hymnal. Turn to page number 314, Amazing Grace. Be long, folks. We'll be up there praising Him forever. Amen. Lord bless you.
Folks, it's good to be here, and we'd like to welcome you to Temple this morning. If you're visiting with us first time today, we'd like you to raise your hand, and we'll give you a card and let you fill it out. Drop in the plate passes in a moment. Anyone first time with us today? All right, some folks down here on the front row, and folks over here. Anyone else first time? We honor our first-time visitors. We want you to know you're in the midst of friends. And we thank the good Lord you're here. Amen. Where are you folks here on the front? Where are you from?
West Virginia.
West Virginia.
Yes.
All right, good.
Amen.
Good, good to have you. All right, you folks back over here?
Louisville, Kentucky.
Louisville, Kentucky. All right, good. Good to have you. Good to have you here with us today. We're having an afterglow, ages 10 to teens. And this will be from 12 till 6 this afternoon. And they have quite a bit scheduled. This is at the Top Golf. And I do not have a clue what the Top Golf is. But I know the kids are going to enjoy it. Amen. They know what it is. So that's all that matters. And then we have Afterglow November the 20th, which is next Sunday, 7 to 8:30 Temple Youth. Be Glow in the Dark Turkey Shoot. I know what turkey shoot is, amen. And they'll be having that s'mores, bonfire, food, fun, and prizes. Keep that in mind. Got a lot scheduled for our kids. I want you to let the kids take part in it. They don't have to be a member of the church. Yes, sir.
If you look at your bulletin today, it's going to be the last day for food bags that are going to be a part for families that may be in need here during Thanksgiving season. So there's a box coming back for
Hunger takes no holidays.
Amen.
Read a card. Thank you. Thank you, Preacher Linda, and the whole church for the cards, care package, gift cards, and most of all, the prayers during my surgery and continued recovery. Amanda Floyd, keep praying for this dear soul that God would heal her. Amen.
All right, brother. I'd like to invite the choir up. We'll be singing out of the folder this morning, page number 32. What a day that will be. All that will come sing. Visitors, you're welcome to sing if you'd like. Come on up. If you would stand again, get your All-American Church hymnal, turn to page number 307. Revive us again. I need it, folks.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, find the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, find the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of life, who has shown us our Savior and scattered. Revive us again.
Be seated as the choir can play.
Serve a risen Savior, folks. Amen. He's not dead. Though the churches are dead and the people are dead, he's not dead. Let's have the ushers come up. We'll take up the morning offering. Father, bless your word, time we have together. May the sweet Holy Spirit have freedom in this house. May he do what he wants to do today. God, help us come before you. Lord, let there be humility in this house. Our Father, some conviction and some real love. And Father, people that are really seeking your face, bless the offering now and time we have together. In Jesus' name, amen. Music, folks. I could listen to that forever. Brother Sam Enzer's singing for us this morning.
I sing when I preach. I like to sing. I get a lot of comments about my singing. But I ignore it. Just keep on singing. I had a good mentor. In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the waters cool flow, bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through his blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song. In the night season, sorrows befall us and Satan oppose, God leads his dear children along. Through grace we can conquer, defeat all our foes, God leads his dear children along. His dear children along. Away up in glory, eternity's day, God leads his dear children along. Help me on the course. Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through his blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song. In the night season and all the day long.
That's good. That's good. That's good. If you have your Bible, turn to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 15 with me this morning, please. Church at Corinth had all kinds of problems. He uses this 15th chapter to spell out a very simple explanation of what the gospel is. Now, there's a lot of study that can go into the issue of the gospel. Paul talked about my gospel and so forth, and that in itself is a great study. But we're coming to the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians and verse number 1. This is going to be a very important message this morning. So I would that you listen carefully to what we say. The Word of God says in verse 1, 1 Corinthians 15, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which also ye are saved. If you keep in memory what I preach to you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, that's Peter, then of the 12, and that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to this present, but some are fallen asleep. And after that he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And then in verse 8, the apostle Paul, who wrote this, said, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. Father, bless this holy word. As it goes forth, Lord, all I can do, all I can be, is the messenger before you today. But our Heavenly Father, the sweet Holy Spirit now, can go far beyond what I could ever think to do. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. A lot of people, you ask them what the gospel is, they say, well, you live a good life, be a good person, and your good deeds will outweigh your bad deeds. Then you have hope that you can go to heaven. A lot of people believe, well, the gospel, if I've been baptized, I know surely I must be saved. Another one says, I've been confirmed. My church confirmed me, so I know therefore I must be a Christian. Someone says to me, well, then preacher, I keep the Ten Commandments, do the best I can. What more could God ask of me? And then they think that's the gospel. Let me say, first of all, the center point of the gospel, without him, it is absolutely no gospel, is the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the foundation, basis, message for everything about this Bible. If what the message is, it does not point to Christ, you didn't hear anything. If it's the gospel without Christ, it's no gospel. He is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Therefore, if you're a true witness of God, you're a witness of Christ. For there's no approach to the Father but by the Son. No man knows the Father but the Son. No man knows the Son but the Father. So I declare unto you the gospel. The gospel, therefore, is based upon one absolute event. Remove it from the gospel and it loses its power. So what is that, preacher? The resurrection of Christ from the dead. And the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians is all about the resurrection of Christ from the dead. Then he moves on the latter part of the 15th chapter and he gets into the essence of what kind of body you have. Then he brings in verse number 50, 51, the great mystery of the rapture of the church of the living God, which is called our blessed hope. And we look for that right now, for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. He that hath this hope in himself purifies himself even as he is pure. So let's look at the text. In verse number 20 and 23 of 1 Corinthians 15, it says this, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. People rose from the dead before him, but they died again. The Lord Jesus Christ is the first one to rise from the dead, therefore breaking the power of death. And death could have no more power over him. Therefore, he could not die again. Hallelujah to God. He broke death's back. And then he rose from the dead. Amen. The Bible tells us here in 1 Corinthians 15 that if we do not preach this resurrection of Christ, if it is not real, then our message is fallacious. It is a lie. It is a midway barker that's giving you some kind of snake oil this morning if Christ did not rise from the dead. And the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15 that if he did not rise from the dead, our preaching is useless. We're just making a lot of noise about nothing. If Christ be not risen from the dead, the witness of the early apostles, these are the sent ones that sat by the fire with him, they have no message to preach whatsoever if Christ be not risen from the dead. And then if Christ be not risen, 1 Corinthians 15, then you are still in your sins. You've been living in a fairy tale land. Those of you that think your sins have been forgiven and you've been made free from the power of sin, it's all been a joke. My friend, if Christ be not risen, and if Christ be not risen, your loved ones, and we stand before a huge cemetery right here behind us, you can walk into that cemetery and walk through the necropolis and go through the land of the dead, and there is no hope whatsoever. You ought to get on the internet and read what these atheists and agnostics have to say about dying. You ought to read about the sorrow they're facing and no hope, and they've lost their mother and their father, and they'll never see them again. And I say to the atheists and agnostics today, what do you have to offer me? You got nothing. You have no message. Who are you? You're nothing more than just another dead man walking upon this earth. But I've got a message. We've got hope. He's called that blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. Acts chapter 26 and verse 22 says, having therefore obtained help of God, I continue to this day, witnessing both to the small and great, saying none of the things and those which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer, that he should be the first that should rise from the dead and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. Acts 17:2, and Paul, as a manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ, over and over and over again, because of its absolute importance, because of its top priority, that everything else hinges upon it. If Christ be not risen, then you're still in your sins, and there is no hope for any of us. Matthew chapter 12, verse 39, as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the hole in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. This is a type. A type in the Old Testament is a picture and a foreshadowing of something that's coming in the New Testament. Sometimes the type gets into lengthy detail. Sometimes it's kind of a shady thing, but it's still a type, and it's pointing to something in the future. And Jonas was a type of Christ, gone for 3 days. And on the third day, that whale could hold him no longer. And it opened that big mouth, and out came this man, bleached white from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. And here he came upon the shore, and the first thing out of his mouth, repent. No doubt would have scared anybody to death to see what he looked like. But you know something, friend? He is a type of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord said in Matthew 16, verse 4, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. There should be no sign given unto it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. And then from that time forth, Jesus began to show his disciples how that he must go into Jerusalem, suffer many things of the elders, chief priests, be killed, and be raised again the third day. The resurrection of Christ proves some things. Number one, it proves that God is. God raised him from the dead. You're not sure God is? My friend, I'm going to tell you something. Why don't you try him? Try him. Try him. Put him to the test. You won't make him mad. Oh, no, you won't upset him one bit. Walk out there in the dark one night, look up at that vast array of stars and say to yourself, where'd all this come from? If there's a God in heaven, make yourself known to me, and he will make himself known to you. Why don't you do it? You're afraid to, that's why. Because your pride's eating you up. You spend all your life bragging to people how there is no God. You're a Gnostic. You're an atheist. Try him one time, and you'll find out why we're here today, and why this preacher's preaching, and why we've got joy in our soul, and why we know whom we have believed, and he's able to keep that which I've committed to him against that day. He raises the dead. Hallelujah to God. Proves that God is. Acts 26 and verse 8 says this, why should it be thought a thing incredible with you that God should raise the dead? Amen. Amen. Well, I just have a hard time believing that, preacher. He raised the dead. He that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot. Who was that? Bound, been dead 4 days. You know who it is. He came, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth. Why? Because life-giving word went forth. The hour is coming when all that are in the grave shall hear the voice of the Son of Man, Son of God, and come forth. Amen. Amen. At his voice they will. The resurrection of Christ proves that Jesus Christ is who he claimed to be. Listen to this, Romans 1:4. And declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Oh, how they wanted to keep him in the tomb. Oh, how the stories that the Jews twisted. And they have a book called The Passover Plot to this day. They just can't stand the idea that this Jew 2,000 years ago came out of a tomb. But my friend, they sealed it. They put the Roman guard there. I'll tell you right now, at the hazard of their own life, they kept that tomb sealed. No way in the world could he come out of that tomb. You kidding? The one who walks through walls on the third day, stone or no stone, he came out of that tomb and he lives today. And I'll tell you right now, he still lives. He's alive forevermore. And death and hell could never touch him again. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ proves that he's the Savior of the world. Romans 4:25, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. The theological idea, the doctrine of how that God put upon the Lord Jesus Christ all the sins of mankind, how he became the propitiation for our sins, all these big words, they're tied up with the Lord Jesus Christ, but God used Christ to tear down the wall between God and man. And the Lord Jesus Christ is the one who can touch heaven.
Thank you, Lord.
And he can touch man. He's the only one that can do that. In one hand, he has the Father. In the other hand, he's got me. Take my hand, Lord, because I want to touch the Father too. Do you believe that? I believe it with all of my soul. The resurrection of Christ proves that he's the Savior of the world. Romans 10:9, thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. Believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You notice how that the resurrection of Christ is right smack in the middle of salvation? There is no salvation without it. The resurrection of Christ proves that he gives the Spirit of life, the Spirit of the living God. Let me tell you something. You can believe what I can believe. You can know more about the Bible than I ever thought of knowing. You can quote every catechism there is. You can know everything there is to know about church history. You can be the most dedicated, consecrated, religious person that's ever walked the face of this earth. But if you're not born again, let me tell you the difference between you and me. The Spirit of the living God dwells within my soul. And if he's not in your soul, I'll know it, because there's no relationship. You don't get excited about Christ. You get excited about yourself. You get excited about your achievements. You get excited about all the accolades people have laid upon you. But at the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, nothing moves within you. It ought to. If you know him, it should begin to move today. That he lives, and he lives within me. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah to God. 1 Corinthians 15:2, by which also you're saved. If you keep in memory what I preached to you, lest you believed in vain. For I delivered you first of all that which I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. They cannot be broken. The word of God cannot be broken. And then the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is the Spirit of life. Know what he says in Romans 8:11. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Scientific achievement has leaps and bounds today. It is progressing like you wouldn't believe. I'm telling you right now, artificial information? No, there's another word. Intelligence. Thank you, brother. Artificial intelligence today. They are recreating the lives of loved ones that have gone on. If they can capture their voice, if they have the photographs and so forth, they can create an image of a thing moving in front of you that looks like your son, your daughter, your husband, and your wife. So when are they going to do that? Right now. They're doing things that people never even imagined could be done. And they're moving leaps and bounds to the next stage in what they're doing. Everything, men to the moon, DNA, all of that. But here's something. They come up to a brick wall, an insurmountable wall. And what is that? It is the hour of death. They cannot tell you, the wisest man on this earth, what lies one moment beyond death. I can. The rich man died and was buried. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes. That's what the Bible says. Beyond what your eye, what your intelligence, what your technology could ever reach, the moment you leave this body, you are present with the Lord. if you're born again. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah to God. They cannot cross that barrier because they are completely and totally ignorant of what lies beyond the grave. That's something. In the rebuke of Christ in Luke chapter 24, verse 25, then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart to believe all the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them the scriptures, the things concerning himself. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. John chapter 20, verse number 9. Let me tell you how hard it is to believe in the resurrection of Christ. It's a natural thing. Do you realize that when the Lord Jesus Christ arose from the dead and the women came back and told the disciples that he had arisen from the dead, the disciples thought they were crazy. Did you know that? Have you read that in the Bible? That makes me believe the Bible because it tells you what people are as they are, not some made up fancy thing. Oh, how in the world? Somebody said, well, Thomas, yes, Thomas. When they told Thomas that he had appeared to them, Thomas said, I'm not going to believe. I cannot believe. And 8 days later, the Lord Jesus Christ appears to them. And Thomas is with him. And man, you just have to put yourself there. When the Lord Jesus appears to these disciples, they're all standing around. And he locks his eyes on Thomas and says, Thomas, Thomas, how do you think you would have felt? Thomas, come here. Come over here, Thomas. Thomas, come here. Put your finger into these nail prints. Thomas, no, no. Woo! No! I believe. The Lord Jesus said, you believe because you've seen, Thomas. Blessed are they that believe and have not seen. That's me. I can't put my hand in those nail prints. But you better believe that I believe. Sure as I stand before you this morning. Thomas, Thomas, Thomas. Peter proclaimed in Acts chapter number 13, verse number 35. Listen to what Peter said. Do you remember him? Yeah. Wherefore he saith also in another psalm, thou shalt not suffer thine holy one to see corruption. For David, after he had served his own generation with the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid to his fathers and saw corruption. But he, whom God raised again, saw no corruption. Do you believe Peter? Do you believe Peter? He said, I knew him, handled him. I was with him on the mount. He was one of the disciples, sat by on the way, by the fireside with him, watched him raise the dead. He was standing there when Lazarus came forth, watched him walk on the water. That's Peter, folks. Either believe him or you don't. If you believe the Bible, what a world it opens up for you. When you believe the Bible, what the joy that can come into your soul. When you believe the Bible, you can say to yourself, God has communicated to us. Yes, he has, and he's going to again. And he does now. Hallelujah to God for the word of God. Amen. Here's some of the resurrection appearances of Christ. It's important enough for them to include it in the Bible. Look at this. After his resurrection, he appeared to Mary Magdalene early on that Easter Sunday morning. She was there at the tomb. She wasn't at the synagogue. She was at the tomb. She wasn't at the temple. She was at the tomb. So why didn't she go to the synagogue or the temple? Because her heart was at the tomb. That's why she went there. That's where her treasure was. She had seven devils cast out of her. How many of you have had a one devil cast? Don't have to raise your hand now. We don't get any. How many of you still got a devil in you? You know, kid, ask that question too. But let me tell you something. Devils are real. Devils are rid of half of our marriages, probably three quarters of them, are broken up because of demonic influence, satanic influence, the devil. Yes, she had seven of them cast out of her. You think she didn't love him? Oh, yes, she loved him. With all of her heart, she showed up that morning. Everything she believed and believed and everything she cared about was in that tomb. Early on that morning, he appeared. First one, Mary Magdalene, privileged. Of all the rest of them, Mary Magdalene. Then the women appeared to them and they went running to the disciples. We've seen the Lord. He's alive. You sound like foolish women, they said. Well, then what do you believe, apostles? What motivates you? and then Peter. Apparently, the Bible says in the book of Luke 24, verse 34, he appeared to Peter. I thought to myself, no, wait a minute. Didn't Peter come running with John to the tomb? He did. John outran Peter to the tomb, didn't he? And this was on the resurrection morn. So why does the Bible pick him out particularly and say the Lord appeared to Peter? Well, Peter might have walked into that tomb and he looked at him where he had been. And he probably walked out more guilt now than he'd ever had. Probably eaten up with the fact that he had denied him and turned from him. And he walked off into the field and said, well, it's a good thing that happened, but look at me. Look what I've done. Is there anything here for me? And out in the field somewhere, he heard a footstep come up behind him. He heard a voice call to him, Peter. He knew that voice. Come here, Peter. Come here, Peter. And he forgave him right there on the spot. No longer, no more, no problem. Peter witnessed the resurrected Christ, witnessed to such a point that he wrote 1st and 2nd Peter, which are two of the finest books in the whole Bible. Spend a little time in 1st and 2nd Peter. He'll carry you through from the creation all the way to the second advent. Peter, 1st and 2nd Peter. And then the two on the road to Emmaus, walking along, minding their own business. All of a sudden, this stranger appears to them. And that day he walked with them on the road to Emmaus. That evening, when he disappeared from them, he appeared to the disciples. And it was that evening when he disappeared from Emmaus that he appeared with the disciples that Thomas wasn't there. Then 8 days later, old Thomas shows up. How many days later? 8 days. 7 completion, perfection, 8 new beginning. Yeah. New beginning. Take the name of Jesus, Jesus, the New Testament name of Christ. Take that name, do the gematria, which means the numerical value of it. And you know what you come up with? 8, 8, 8. Take the name of man. And you know what number you come up with? 6, 6, 6. 8 is new beginning, new beginning. Everybody that's ever met the Lord Jesus Christ has had a new beginning. Right. Hallelujah to God. I'm so glad there's a lot of stuff behind me I'll never have to face in front of me. It's all gone. Been forgiven. You can't shout because you don't know where I came from. I can shout because I know where I came from. Hallelujah to God. Then at 500 brethren, the Bible said in 1 Corinthians 15, at one time now, we're talking 500 brethren. Then he appeared to the apostles on numerous occasions. Then he appeared to James. Do you know who James was? That was his half-brother. He's the one who wrote the book of James. James and Jude were the half-brothers of Christ. He appeared to him. Wanted to make a personal appearance. You're my half-brother, James. Appeared to him at the resurrection. Boy, James must have felt like he was kind of important for the Lord Jesus to pick him out and appear to him. And then the Bible says he had, when he ascended to heaven, he ascended to glory. Do you know why he ascended? Because the earth couldn't hold him anymore. That's right. The only thing the earth could do to him was crucify him and put him in a tomb. And he came out of the tomb and he arose from the dead and he ascended to the right hand of the Father. Let me tell you something now. That ascension of Christ is so very important because it has to do with his righteousness. He ascended into the very presence of Almighty God and came in into his presence into the righteous one. God Almighty is absolute righteousness. Yet here is one that's going to come to him that's a man. And the man, Christ Jesus, entered into his presence by his own righteousness. And then you have the righteousness of the God-man and the righteousness of God the Father merged together, and the Father says, sit down at my right hand. Amen. That's righteousness. And that righteousness, dear friend, that righteousness of the God-man that rose from the dead becomes your righteousness. When he's made unto us righteousness, no longer just imputed to your account. No, far greater than that. He's made unto you righteousness, the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. So it says to Thomas. Now I want to read something for you. The Bible says in Luke 24, verse 44, he said unto them, these are the words which I spake to you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were spoken in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms. These are the three major divisions of the Old Testament: the Torah, the Navim, and the Ketuvim. The Torah, the Word of God, the law. The Navim, the prophets. The Ketuvim, the writings. In plain words, all of the Old Testament bore witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. It's quite remarkable, too. The Sadducees would only accept the first five books of the Bible, just like the Samaritans. The Samaritans have their Pentateuch, and they only accept the first five books of the Bible. Out with the writings, out with the prophets. But my goodness gracious, friend, could you throw out Isaiah? Could you throw out the 53rd chapter of Isaiah? Could you throw out the 22nd Psalm? Could you throw these out? No, you can't throw them out, because they testify of Him. And so the Word of God is fulfilled in Him. And the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse, it sets out in stages the way God deals with mankind, the end. And the first thing that the Lord Jesus Christ says to John, He said, John, He said, I am He that liveth and was dead. And behold, John, I'm alive forevermore. Now note the tense. I am He that liveth. I'm the living one. I'm the living one. There is no other living one like that living one. He said, John, I am He that liveth and was dead. He didn't say they killed me. He said, I was dead. He laid His life down. And He said, now look, John, behold, I'm alive forevermore. So what does that mean? That means it qualifies Him to do everything that He does in the book of Revelation, because He rose from the dead. Death is the judgment. Death is an enemy. Death is hell to those on this earth. Death is something that some people do just it worries them to death, and they think constantly, "What, I'm going to die," and they live in morbidity because they're thinking about death, and death is the most uncertain thing to all of us. But here's the thing about it. If you're born again, if you're truly born again, the only thing that can die is the body. That's it. And it makes your spirit, sets your spirit free. Before this sun goes down today, this old boy right here may have preached his last sermon. If it is, I'll tell you this. I love you. I'm not mad at you. I told you what's in my heart. I believe in the resurrected Christ. I do. I believe in Him. I don't know what's going to happen to me, but I know where I'm going. I know who I believe in. Early this morning, about 5:30, 6 o'clock, I was listening to BBN, the Bible Broadcasting Network. It's 95.3 FM here in Knoxville, and I don't know wherever you may be, somewhere else. I listen to that station all the time. Now, that's, other stations got some good stuff too, but I listen to BBN. And this morning a song came on. I hadn't heard it in a long time. And man, it grabbed me. Oh, isn't it a beautiful thing when something just grabs you like that? Oh, yeah. You want to hear the words? Early this morning. If you've knelt beside the rubble of an aching, broken heart, when the things you gave your life to fell apart, you're not the first to be acquainted with sorrow, grief, or pain, but the Master promised sunshine after the rain. Yes. Hold on, my child, joy comes in the morning. Yes. Weeping only lasts for the night. Hold on, my child, joy comes in the morning. The darkest hour means dawn is just in sight. To invest your seed of trust in God in mountains you can't move, you have risked your life on things you cannot prove. But to give the things you cannot keep for what you cannot lose is the way to find the joy God has for you. The darkest hour means dawn is just in sight. Name of that song, Joy Comes in the Morning. That's beautiful. Oh, Lord have mercy. I looked in both of these songbooks here, and it's not in either one of them. Joy comes in the morning. You talk about beautiful. That's beautiful. Man, if I could sing, I'd sing that. But I can't sing a lick. God said, get out of here when He started handing out gifts for singing.
gave you a big mouth, that's all you're getting. Go on. So, no singing, but oh, how this lady touched my soul. Would you like to hear it sung? Pray God somewhere, raise somebody up that can sing this. All right? Put it in somebody's heart. Put it in their heart that they sing this. Father, bless your word. Thank you for the time we've had together. Thank you for your word. Father, it goes deep into the heart and soul of a man. It's the seed, our Heavenly Father. It's not corrupt, can't corrupt. It's your word. Satan can't do anything with it except try to steal it away. It's your word. It's perfect. It's pure. It's holy. I pray you'd bless it today. Somebody heard this morning and they know God spoke to them. They know he did. They know he did. I wish that they'd do something about it. I wish they wouldn't keep putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. Why don't you do something about it this morning? The Holy One wants to talk to you. He wants to put his arms around you. He wants to speak to you. He wants to comfort you. He wants to help you. He wants you to understand how wonderful that resurrection of Christ is, because he's victor now over death, hell, and the grave. Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The apostle cried, oh, death, where is thy sting? In Jesus' name. Before you raise your, anybody looks, I want you, anybody in this house this morning, raise your hand and say, Preacher Lawson, God spoke to me. Pray for me. I will. That's what we're here for. God bless you. God bless you. Got hands up everywhere. Anybody else? Anybody else? God bless you. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus for the hands that were raised, Lord. I've sowed the seed, Father. I'm the messenger. I've done that. As far as I can go, Lord. I pray you'd bless it now. Help these dear folk. Those that raised their hand this morning, let them look deep in their heart. Let them search out their soul. And let them walk with you now. In Jesus' name. Won't you come? How we sing. What have we got, brother?
Page 403 in the All-American Church hymnal, Pass Me Not.
Joy comes in the morning. Your morning could be today. Oh, yeah. Your morning could be today. Wouldn't it be something? You walked in here under a shadow and a burden, walk out of here rejoicing and praising God. Wouldn't that be something?
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. Why? Thou art called. Do not pass me by.
Savior, 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 Savior.
Savior, Savior.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Savior.
Hear my humble cry.
While on others
thou art called.
Do not pass me by.
Do not pass me by.
I listen to Johnny Erickson Tata all the time, and I heard her yesterday say something, and I thought it was pretty good. You need to hear it. You know who I'm talking about. She's a quadriplegic, has been since her teens. And she was talking about how that when they get in there, they have a van that carries her. They get in that van, and they all get in there, and they start quoting scripture, and they start singing, and they start praising God. And she says, the minute we start doing that, said the spirit immediately changes, and we have joy, and we have power. Come into that van. When we start praising God and joy and glorifying God, singing to him, praying, talking. See, all go together, folks. You can sing 1 second and be praying the next second, and then singing again the next second. They go together, see. They're of the same spirit. And that does something for you. That does something for you. Satan wants to keep you defeated. He wants to keep you depressed. He wants you to keep you beat down. He wants to keep you feeling like a victim. That's where he wants to keep you, and that's where he will keep you if you let him. But why don't you say today, Lord Jesus, I'm coming out of this hole. I'm going to glorify your holy name. If you rose from the dead, there's nothing then, therefore, that can stop us. Nothing. Nothing. In Jesus' name, he lives. How many believe he lives?
Amen.
Yeah, he lives. Amen. He lives. Sing another verse, brother.
Let me at a throne of mercy find a sweet
Father, thank you, Lord, time we have together. Our Father, I felt that spirit that fights us this morning. He's here. But greater is he that is within us than he that's in this world. And victory's ours. It's already been won. All we have to do is claim it. We don't have to get the victory. Victory's already done. It's settled. Christ is victor. I pray this in Jesus' name. Keep the folks safe and bring them back safe again this evening. Keep our kids safe this afternoon, Lord, as they have this good time together. Yes. Bless them, Father. May they enjoy it. May they enjoy it. We ask in Jesus' name and amen. God bless you. See, it's 6 o'clock, folks. 6 o'clock.